Head of the Motion Picture Association of America, Jack Valenti, said today in New York that the film industry plans to set up a voluntary rating system designed to keep youngsters from seeing undesirable films.
10 years ago on this very day, November 1st, 1968, the film industry stopped censoring and it started a rating system. The system has since been praised. It's also been condemned.
For 30 years, the Motion Picture Association of America has been helping parents decide what movies they should let their children see. But lately, their decisions have come under fire.
Encino, California, inside the headquarters of the Motion Picture Association of America, an anonymous group of parents gathers to rate films G, PG, PG-13, R, and NC-17, formerly X. But the MPAA won't let anyone inside to see who these people are or how they make their decisions. And among their most controversial decisions are the films they rate NC-17.
My film was very autobiographical. It was very reflective of many of the girls that I knew, you know, in downtown New York who were passing as men. So I was in the editing room and I got a call from my producer and he said, "We have some bad news. You got an NC-17. And I was like, "That's great." Because I thought, oh, NC-17, all the films that I love have it, you know. They were like, "Oh, that used to be an X." They were like, "No, that's not good." And I was like, "Well, why?" And they said, "Well, because the studio won't release your movie if it has an NC-17. I was so floored to have worked so hard against all the obstacles of no money and all the obstacles of people saying, "You can't make a movie like this, it doesn't make sense," getting the audiences to love it at that point, and then to have this unknown board that was apparently doing it for the filmmaker, right, because that's kind of the whole mantra, saying that I couldn't have my meaning. It was like being shut out from a system where, like, it was like, "Wait, let me talk to you. This can't make, this isn't right." So I said to my lawyer, "Well, what were the counts? You know, what were the problems?" Well, there were three. After Brandon goes down on Lana, he comes up and he wipes the cum off his mouth. So we had a strike on that. I said, "Okay, what's the problem?" "Well, we don't really know, but that's really offensive." So I was like, so I shoot Brandon in the head and I do all these things to him, and that's fundamentally okay, but there's a problem here, yes. Can somebody explain that? No. Is there anybody I can call? No. "Okay, what's the second one?" "The anal rape. They want you to cut it out." And I was like, "Well, I'm not cutting it out. That's just inherent to the movie." "So what's the third thing?" "Well, Lana's orgasm is too long." And I was like, "Okay, well, who's ever been hurt by an orgasm that was too long?" "Well, it's offensive." And I was like, "That's outrageous." So when I looked at Lana's orgasm, I was like, "Oh, this is totally about Lana's pleasure. So there's something about that that's scaring them, that's unnerving them."
Well, so why do you think they had a problem with it?
With female pleasure?
Yeah.
Well, in a construct where most movies are written by men, directed by men, they're mostly the male experience. So I think that, and even in sex scenes, I think that it's from a male perspective. So I don't think that the focus is female pleasure. I think that female pleasure is unnatural. I think female pleasure is scary in the kind of narrative setting. So I think that if you're a woman who understands female pleasure and understand it from, you know, from the woman's perspective, you're probably going into terrain that's unfamiliar. So, and I think generally unfamiliarity is what breeds these NC-17s.
I definitely felt censored, and I felt discriminated against for making a gay film.
We were told anything with a dildo would have to be removed.
Give me the physical frame. Where exactly do we go from a PG to an R?
They give you this list in the beginning that has every single thing that couldn't be on television.
I had to cut one shot where you just infer that one of the girls is like going towards the crotch of the other girl.
There was some pressure from the studio to cut back a bit.
And in the end, they cut 3 seconds, I think it was.
And the MPA members will tell you, well, you don't have to accept the rating. It's not mandatory. That's bullshit.
Why should that movie get an R?
I do
and
anticipate
why,
some
for seeing my pubic
obviously
hair, do we get
there
an
is one such a problem for
portraying
black.
It's a terrible situation.
The current rating system is a form of censorship in a kind of fundamental way, because it categorizes films in advance of their release, and they're categorized not by the people who make them, but by a handful of people whose names we'll never know.
The rating board members, who are parents, neither gods nor fools, look at a movie and try to put a rating on there that the average parent would believe to be an accurate depiction of that film.
This mythical American parent, you know, is a fiction, you know, a convenient fiction that somebody has to make up to come up with this, what has got to be an arbitrary system.
They're told that they're guardians of morality. They're told that they're the last bar between what, with respect to what children shall see. So vested with that kind of authority, they tend to take themselves seriously. And they tend to try and promulgate some concepts that they basically make up. They try and make up standards.
The critical community has never really taken the MPAA terribly seriously or given it a huge amount of respect. And we're often, you know, very puzzled by some of the decisions they make, and why this is, you know, why people can't go see this terrific movie just because it has, you know, this word in it. You know, it just seems so kind of childish, even though it's supposed to protect children, you know, it's turning us all into children.
What do movie ratings mean? G means general audiences. No nudity, no sex, and no drugs. Violence must be cartoonish and minimal. And there may be language that goes beyond polite conversation. PG means parental guidance. There may be strong language, like shit or ass, and brief nudity, like showing off an ass, or light violence, like getting kicked in the ass. PG-13. Parents are strongly cautioned, as in, look out, Mom, here come more shits. Bullshit, dumb shit, little shit, shit-faced, and shithead. Fuck is also allowed, but usually just once, so filmmakers are urged to choose their fuck carefully. A simple fuck you is okay, but referring to the sexual act as in, may I please fuck you, or I enjoy getting fucked, is totally unacceptable. If a character says that, especially while abusing an illegal narcotic, the film is rated R. R means restricted. No children 17 or under without parent or guardian. There may be sexual themes, frank sex talk, sexualized nudity, tough language, and tough violence, like 1,000 handicapped orphans decimated by a hail of gunfire. But if the film depicts realistic baby-making in a position other than missionary, acts involving oral sex with females, anal sex, fetishes, more than 2 humans, or what the MPAA deems aberrational behavior, that film could get slapped with an NC-17. NC-17 means no children 17 or under, period. An NC-17 may range from a senior citizen gangbang to a foreign Pedro Almodovar film. But art films make people feel funny, especially the ones with aberrational behavior.
We have censorship board called the MPAA that looks at your movie and says, this is the rating we're going to give you, and if you want it to be any more extreme, just expect 5 people to see your film. And no advertising budget, no distributor is going to want to touch it.
I have Valenti's Law, which says, if you make a movie that a lot of people want to see, no rating will hurt you. If you make a movie that few people want to see, no rating will help you. Ratings have nothing to do with box office.
The difference between NC-17 and R rating could be millions of dollars. It could mean the difference
on some films, maybe even tens of millions of dollars, because it definitely limits your ability to market the film. If you're limited on your ability to market a film, people aren't aware of it, they're not going to know to even go to the theater to see that movie.
And if you choose not to accept the rating, then your ads don't really run. You can't run TV spots. You can't, like, if they run a TV spot for a movie that hasn't been rated yet, they say, this film has not yet been rated. But you never see TV spots for, like, this film is unrated.
The worst censorship of all, I believe, is Walmart, Blockbuster. All the big chains that are probably responsible for 40% of all videos sold, DVDs, will not carry NC-17.
Jack Valenti's been very good and publicly about, we serve the public, we serve the parents, we serve, it's a crap. They serve the studios. That's who pays their bills. That's who they are. I mean, they are the studios.
Does the perennial charge that the studios were treated better than the independents hold true? My answer, I'm sorry, in terms of when I was there, was absolutely no.
Orgasmo!
When we did Orgasmo, which was completely independently financed, they gave us an NC-17. You know, we got this phone call with the MPAA, and the guy would basically say, it's for the overall sexual content. I said, was there anything we can cut out to get an R? You know, you're welcome to recut it and send it back to us, and we'll certainly look at it again. And their whole position was, when we did this film, was we don't give specific notes, because then we'd be a censorship organization. We just give you the rating. And cut to 5 years later, we're doing the South Park movie, and now we're working for Paramount, it's a big studio. And we turned in the first cut of the movie, and we get a phone call, and you got an NC-17. Well, he needed to cut out this, this, change this to this, 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 and it was extremely specific. This word, this line, this joke. So our treatment was a completely different experience.
They target independents because the system just is set up to favor the studios. And because the independent filmmaker is independent of the studios, I mean, what's independent film? What is it independent of? It's independent of that big studio culture. Looking for more freedom, looking to be able to operate in a manner where they can completely express themselves without restriction and without censorship.
There's a mystery here, though. Who is controlling this thing, and how are they controlling it? Because I don't fully understand yet.
Would you like to know?
Oh, yeah.
We've looked at rating systems across 30 different countries. The MPAA system is the only movie rating system that doesn't disclose who its rating board members are.
I think that does rankle with a lot of people, and rightly so. You know, who are these people that are sitting in judgment of your movie? You know, you'd like to know.
No one knows. That's the whole point. That's what's really odd about the whole thing, that in an industry as big and as public as this, that there's an organization that is like the supposedly accountable to the public that is run in such a shadowy way.
Okay, so one of the things we're doing is we're actually hiring a private investigator to try to find out who these people are on the board.
Oh, that's great.
Hi, my name is Kirby Dick, and I was interested in actually hiring a private investigator for a project that I'm about to begin working on. How hard would it be, and what methods would you use to find out, you know, who these people are and where they live?
We'd find out when the screening is.
Right.
We'd do surveillance on the building.
Mm-hmm.
Get the license plates of all those vehicles.
I could get myself employed at a low-level position where I'm inside, where I can find those things out.
What about, like, can you go through people's trash and stuff like that?
In the city of Los Angeles, it's completely legal to do that, as long as it's on the street.
Do you do much undercover work?
I look like a cop. You know, I couldn't get away with any kind of undercover work. But I know lots of people who don't look like cops.
Being a woman, I get in places that most people don't. That's
usually
one
security,
advantage.
Yeah, usually security guards open the door.
I'll smile and they open the door and in I go.
I have wigs and hats and things like that when it's necessary. That's my hooker wig.
But if it came down to where I needed her or her daughter, I'd bring them with me. But I definitely do everything in my power to get in.
Okay, the MPAA is a pinkish color building, and they've got it all to where it's impossible for you just to walk onto the premises. Here they have an intercom, and a security guy will come on and ask you what you want. He won't let you come in. It's all gated in here, locked and secure, so there's absolutely no way of going in unless you're invited. And I don't think they're going to invite us. So there's absolutely no way we're going to get in that building.
Okay, well, it's lunchtime right now, so they're going to all start coming out. We'll take some plates, get some information.
All right. What are you looking at now?
That security guard over there.
Is he going to make it harder to do what we have to do, you think?
No, unless he starts looking at us. There was one moment where I thought he did look over here,
really?
So I just want to make sure.
Yeah. You think so?
But he just probably glanced.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Lindsay, we have a black Honda. Female, Caucasian.
5XF 3CV. I kind of get a thrill out of knowing I'm watching someone and they don't know they're being watched. There's something exciting about that. I mean, so, Lindsay, write this down. 4SWF 3, brand new Mercedes. Very attractive woman, whoever she is. So it's a slow process. This could take 6 months, and I'm not even sure if it's possible. I mean,
this is like saying go into Fort Knox and bring out a few bricks. We just want to see what color they are.
Okay, I was a full-time motion picture raider with the MPAA for about 4.5 years, from September of 1995 to March of 2000. I believe the starting salary at that time for a full-time raider was $30,000.
Generally, in the morning, you would meet and discuss the movies that you had seen the previous day. And so first, people would kind of talk about them if there was any issue that, this seemed kind of violent, or there's too much sex here, or people would sort of give their opinions on why they thought it should be one rating or another.
There weren't any clear set of standards that in a sense you were taught and then had to apply. There was no kind of raider training process. People were hired, they were put into the screening room, put in the rating chair, and started rating films.
Sometimes they would show us like an edited version of the movie after it had been given like an X or an R rating and they wanted to change it. And oh, the board would be very pleased when they would saw the re-edited version. They'd say, oh, this is much better the way that we told them how to re-edit the film. It plays much better now. And I found that to be very offensive.
I'm gonna say the F word, you know? And I believe it's the fascist system. I mean, they have just established themselves, they have injected themselves as a vital, necessary entity, and it isn't. You know, we have to police these people. We have to determine that these people have you know, our best intentions in mind. And if they don't, then we will correct them.
Well, you can't talk about the history of film without talking about the history of censorship. And most people see Will Hayes as the sort of first formal attempt on the part of the industry as a whole to institute self-regulation.
News on the march. The Roaring Twenties choke on the exhaust of Hollywood scandal. Chief offender, Fatty Arbuckle, a comedian turned murder suspect after a starlet dies at his raunchy Tinseltown party. Under fire as Sin City, major studios form the Motion Picture Producers and Distributors Association, hiring Postmaster General Will Hayes to restore decency to the movies by implementing a strict production code.
But in the 1950s, you have a handful of films that get released that challenge the PCA. The first is The Moon is Blue.
You won't mind coming up, will you?
I'm not so sure. Would you try to seduce me?
And it was clear that for Hollywood not to look sort of hopelessly antiquated, they were going to have to figure out a new way to bring reality into the movies.
How about Hump the Hostess, huh? How about that? How about Hump the Hostess? You want to play that one? You want to play Hump the Hostess, huh? Oh, yeah, oh, you want to wait till later. Get her off into the bushes.
Hump the Hostess!
Just shut up, will you?
The language in Virginia Woolf was really shocking and new. And I think it's really what inspired Jack Valenti to come up with the MPAA rating system.
No film can ever survive the brazen hiss of public scorn.
When Jack Valenti became president of the MPAA back in, I guess, 1966, He came from Washington. He came from the president's office, where he had been Lyndon Johnson's man. And he became the man of Lou Wasserman and of the other owners of Hollywood. He came to serve their interest. He was, came as their lobbyist.
The fact that he did come out of Washington, I think, was, you know, Hollywood felt comfortable that he could protect them from the people that he knew back there, because he was a Washington insider.
And Hollywood, when you ask what their economic interests had to do with ratings, if there weren't ratings and there was censorship, there would be 50 different censor boards.
In my opinion, the MPAA uses the fear of government censorship to keep power and control in the motion picture industry. If you look at the Supreme Court decisions, key decisions in the 1950s and 1960s, there is no real threat of government censorship of the motion picture industry after that time, except for the area of child pornography.
It would be much better if the government came in. I mean, it's wrong for the government to come in, but if those were the two options, you'd rather have the government in, because the government, whatever the government does, is subject at least to some kind of judicial review.
The current rating system is unconstitutional. I mean, if somebody wanted to mount a constitutional case against it, well, it's an agreement. It's an industry agreement. Now, the industry's never been competitive. It's always been collusive. Really, from the very beginning, the studios were vertically integrated monopolies. They controlled development, they controlled production, they controlled post-production, they controlled distribution, and they controlled exhibition. And there were two big strikes. There was the 1941 Disney strike, in which labor won sort of a fairly clear victory. And then you have the 1945 Warner Brothers strike, in which you had the battle between the two big industry unions, and you had the studio hiring scabs, and you had high-powered water hoses used on picketers. And one way of dealing with these increasingly powerful unions was to make participation, membership in a union, dangerous.
Calling the House Un-American Activities Committee to order, Chairman J. Parnell Thomas of New Jersey opens an inquiry into possible communist penetration of the Hollywood film industry.
So during the blacklist, the two questions that were asked routinely at the hearings were,
are you a member of the Communist Party? And have you ever held any position in the Screenwriters Guild?
First of all, asking the two questions together suggests that there's a connection between the two. And asking the second question makes saying yes a very dangerous act. So to confess seems the wrong word, but to confess membership in a union would be tantamount to accepting a life sentence, a blacklist. You know, people generally associate this with McCarthyism. Well, it had nothing to do with McCarthy at all. I mean, once the MPAA got on board, the MPAA did it all themselves. And the blacklist was implemented by the very body that controlled the industry.
There is no subversive propaganda on the American screen, and there isn't going to be. Communists hate our films because they show a way of life that they hate, a life where free men work and play in the ways of freedom.
The Motion Picture Association's always been about public relations, making sure everybody in America is happy with the movie industry. Movie industry appears socially responsible. The movie industry appears to care about everyday Americans.
Well, the Motion Picture Association is composed of the seven largest producers of film and television in the world, the old great studio names, and I've been the head for 34 years. My greatest achievement as head of the MPA is, I survived.
Left the board, it was brought to my attention that I was expected to remain completely silent about any of my experiences on the rating board.
I suddenly was offered a large increase in my salary, but here, sign this, and lo and behold, it was another, you may not ever say anything, write anything, etc., without Jack Valenti's permission.
One thing that I have learned in my long and some would say checkered career is that in Hollywood and Washington, there are no secrets. And when somebody thinks there's a secret, there isn't.
You shall not, during the term of your employment or thereafter, disclose to any other person, firm, or corporation, nor use in any way confidential information relating to the MPAA, which may cause or be calculated to cause injury or loss to any of the above mentioned.
When I asked Joan Graves if they could put in writing what specific forms of information they considered confidential, they refused to do that.
Really?
Yeah. And said, no, we deliberately leave the what's in writing fuzzy so that at any time we can use our discretion as far as suing former employees who disclose what we consider to be too much information. And they indicated that they would not hesitate to sue if they felt that there was injury to their interests.
Thank you for calling Motion Picture Association of America. To access our company directory, please press 9. Please enter the first three letters of the person's last name. There are no matches to the three letters you entered. To try another name, enter 1.
Go down another one.
Please enter the first three letters of the person's last name. Please hold on while I try
to... I thought we were going to get more matches than this.
This is Mary Ann Costanza in the ratings department. I'm either on another line or away from my desk. If you need immediate assistance, please dial 0 for the operator. Thank you.
The ratings. This is the one I think is a raider. Mm-hmm.
That's camera, right?
Yeah,
that's the pinhole. Mm. It's just something I can put on my shirt.
Yeah.
Could you walk into a restaurant with it?
Yeah.
Like, what's your range, your wide range?
It looks like this.
Just right here?
That's good. Ooh, yeah, that's very good.
We'll take this one in the shotgun.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so now today, you want to...
You want to come in or you want to hide in the car?
Yeah, are you cold or are you okay?
Yes, she's cold. But she's going to be wearing, it looks like a button if you're not really, I mean,
oh,
for
wow.
Some.
Wow.
Look
at this.
That's the camera, but if you
It
not,
looks just like a little button.
It looks like a button on a scarf. We did it last night. You wouldn't believe what we were doing.
Oh, let's see the back. Let's see the back.
Well, we just have the wire to go in here. And the reason I wanted her to do it in a scarf is because if the camera's high or too low,
right.
You just pull the scarf
smart.
Up or down. And then everything's hooked up to that camera in sight.
Okay, that sounds cool.
Okay, it is 12:30, so they're gonna come out before 1:30.
Oh, wait, Vicky, look.
Okay, we got a car here. This is a Honda 417. Okay, we got another one. We have someone coming out of that alleyway. That's Mary Ann Costanza right there. They go through that light. No. Oh, shit. They're way ahead of me now. Now I think we lost her. So I think I better turn around and go back and try to catch someone else. A couple people. 4. D-O-N. Oh, a lot of women. We need to go for this one. There's 4 women, which is even better. Now, it may not be raiders, but I have a gut instinct and I just feel really good about it. Watch them, Lindsay. Keep an eye on them. Can you see him? You like them? He's right there at the corner?
Yeah.
Well, they're going to islands and they're parking at the meter. These are raiders. I can feel it. You're okay, Lindsay? Okay, we're going to let them go in before us. Wait, hold on. Let's see. You gotta fix your scarf, Lindsay. Can you see them behind me?
No, I can only see one of them.
Maybe you can get a better shot if you move over.
No, I still can't see them.
Maybe you can get them later. They were talking about editing one of the films. That they should edit a certain part. That's all I could get.
Right.
I was lucky I got that much.
Did we get the license plate?
Yes, we got that.
So, but we don't know who they are is the problem.
No, but you know what? They're so casual. They were talking loud, like normal. And then when they started talking about all that, they got very quiet. Hey, Lindsay, were you able to get a shot of them as you were coming out?
Yeah, I did. You want to take a look? Here, I'll show you.
Oh, good. All right.
This is a good thing. The only thing is we're only going to know the name of the person who's driving the car.
Right.
But and then they were like, oh, they had to get back. And I heard one of them say something about wonder what movie we're going to be seeing.
How'd you like to birdie that hole, huh? You say the word, she's all yours. Anytime, I'll keep a running tab for you. What? She's not your type, what are you kidding me?
I remember what happened. I was just going into a meeting and I got a phone call and it was the producer of the film saying, guess what, we got an NC-17 from the MPAA. And I went, oh, shit. And so I said, was it for that first scene? And they said, no, it was because there was a glimpse of Maria's pubic hair in the second scene. And I was like, what?
Just a couple of months before, I had gone to see a horror film that was rated R. It was a funny horror film. And in the first 10 minutes, a woman gets her fake breasts cut out.
Oh!
And there's blood everywhere. And that's what made me so furious to want to go in and fight for my pubic hair. Was like, don't tell me. I'm a mother. Why should that movie get an R? And why, for seeing my pubic hair, do we get an NC-17? When it was this, you know, a beautiful moment between two people that had a lot to do with love.
You know, by the time we get to the scene they found a fence with, these people are committed to each other. It's a real love story. It's not promoting promiscuity. It's about the intimacy of that situation. And the power of just the camera being on your face is what I think caused the MPAA to give that scene an NC-17. But because they couldn't reach inside themselves and realize why it felt so real, I think the next thing I saw was a glimpse of Maria's pubic hair, and I go, oh, that must be it, you know? And I don't feel anybody who saw the uncut version of that film would have gone home and wanted to rape the next woman on the street or feel like they were brain damaged from seeing a woman's pubic hair. I mean, I just don't know what the big deal is. Everybody sees everybody naked in the world, and we're not showing them something that's never been seen before.
That's what it looks like?
I guess. What does yours look like?
Not like that.
Yeah, let me see.
All right.
They gave us an R on Jersey Girl. And it was based on a conversation that Ben's character and Liv's character have in a diner about masturbation.
If it makes you feel any better, I mean, I do it like twice a day.
Good God.
What can I tell you? I get bored easily.
You're gonna get carpal tunnel syndrome.
Don't get all judgmental with me, you know, slouch yourself.
For some reason, I guess it was because in watching the movie, the MPA was sitting there going, Liv Tyler masturbating on a regular basis, Arwen, the elf, can't have it, you know, and they gave it an R. And I actually spoke to Joan Graves, who's the current head of the MPAA.
Where are we going?
Your place. We're gonna have some sex.
And she was saying it would just make me uncomfortable thinking about my 16-year-old daughter sitting in a movie theater watching that scene. To which I was like, so, but Jim, do you think that your 16-year-old daughter hasn't masturbated already? Like, do you really think there's anything in that scene that this chick done or hasn't already tried when, you know, the lights go out at night or in the bathroom or in the tub or with the shower head or something like that? Like, I'm telling you, man, like, I'm not teaching this broad anything new.
Well, first of all teenagers, because of the internet, have seen more hardcore pornography than their parents have seen. They've seen the most hideous things you can find on the internet, believe me, and they've all seen them. What else do you think they're doing? You think they're doing the homework upstairs? I mean, you know, come on, all kids have searched and gone deep into web porn sites. Who wouldn't as a teenager?
Pretending that it's so damaging and harmful to their growing psyches that, you know, we have to stamp something with a rating that prevents them from seeing it, even with a fucking parent.
We take polls every year by the Opinion Research Corporation, 2,600 people interviewed nationwide. And for the last 20 years, parents, by 70% or more of children under 13, find this rating system very useful to fairly useful in helping them guide their children's viewing.
And they have these bullshit statistics that they bring up where it's like, well, 78% of parents say they find the ratings very useful. And I always feel that it's like, because they're the only game in town, you know, I mean, as compared to nothing at all, they probably are useful. But it's like that Tide commercial where they have the, like the sock that's white and then they show you the whiter one. I always wonder if like, look at their parents, there could be a real ratings board where if you were unhappy with it, there could be real transparency, real accountability if people wouldn't like that more.
Sometimes it seems quite variable. You could swear to yourself that you've seen films that were rated R that had things that were far more problematic than what you're asking for an R. And the irony of it is if it's presented in a sort of shoulder up sort of way, it tends to be an R. And if the camera is further away, where the perspiration doesn't show, where it's not like right in there with them in the bed, but if you see a touch of hip, it's that pelvic thrusting.
Oh, I think there was definitely like a thrust number, yeah.
You really go down to people counting thrust the amount, down. You know, yes.
The amount of
actual thrusting.
Never mind what's your mind. Keep in mind in your work.
Work.
Idle hands, the devil's playground.
Work.
I've always been such a fan of the European filmmakers and the way that they deal with sexuality, which is real people and real bodies, and it's just a part of life and a part of human nature. And I find in this country, we've kind of desexualized sex. We've taken it out of the realm of a day-to-day function and something that is implicit in just being a human being, because we're so afraid of it.
Well, the Europeans have always found America very odd on sexual matters. You know, they've always found us strangely puritanical. And I remember Stanley Kubrick's Eyes Wide Shut. In its R version, they digitally superimposed certain bodies or shadows to cover offending, you know, body parts. But it just seemed so much ado about nothing, you know?
Frankly, in 1970, you saw probably more sexual explicitness in a lot of movies than you'd be seeing now.
You know, a movie that's been playing on TV quite a bit lately is Coming Home, the Hal Ashby movie. And the most amazing scene in the movie is John Boyd going down on Jane Fonda. I mean, here's a guy that's in a wheelchair who's getting this woman off. And she finally experiences what might have been her first orgasm ever. I mean, we start to think that it might be the first time she's ever had an orgasm. And it does spend a lot of time. I mean, it's a long scene. This orgasm lasts a long time, okay? It's like kind of amazing, you know? And when I see it, I'm kind of like, wow, how did they get by with that in the 70s? So I do think that it's a really good point that there's a denial of female pleasure or a denial of pleasure, period. Male pleasure too. I mean, you can't see, you know, you can barely see anything of a male body, you know, on the screen. So I think that nobody gets to come, basically. I think that that's what it is.
I there was always a fear that sex in some ways would dissolve the social bonds, that sex more than violence unleashed sex will take the society apart. You know, and of course that focus varies. Now it's, you know, unleashed gay sex will take the society apart.
Real cutie pie, side, 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 real cutie.
But I'm a Cheerleader was a movie about gay kids who go to a homosexual rehabilitation camp. It's a comedy, it's a teen movie. I mean, it's all the things that I thought kids would like, and I really wanted teens to see it, and I feel like the most important teens to see it are teens that are in high school in like Wyoming or wherever, you know, that are just feeling like they're the only ones, and you know, especially these kids that are sent to these homosexual rehabilitation camps, and those camps are very real. So I got a call from the ratings board, and they said, you got an NC-17. And I was really angry and really devastated, and I didn't understand why, because there's no nudity in the sex scene, and they're fully clothed. It was ridiculous. But the really offensive thing, at the time that I submitted it to the ratings board, American Pie had just come out. I had seen the trailer a million times of Jason Biggs masturbating in an apple pie in the trailer. So the ratings board then tells me that in order to get an R, I have to cut one of my girls masturbating over her underwear, fully clothed, and you don't see anything. Basically, you can tell that she's masturbating.
Ratings board is populated by parents, normal human beings, neither gods nor fools, who make errors of judgment from time to time.
Well, what's really offensive about that is to say, for a rater to say, we're just gonna rate these movies like an average American parent. Who is an average American parent? I'm an American parent. I'm a lesbian. I live in Los Angeles. I'm a filmmaker. I have a daughter. I'm a parent. I pay taxes. And is there anyone on the ratings board who's a parent like me? I highly doubt it.
Were there any gays or lesbians on the board during your tenure?
Well, you know, to my knowledge, there weren't any that were self-proclaimed homosexuals on the board while I was there. No.
You know, if it's the same gender sex, they seem to often have a bigger problem than they do if it's a man and a woman.
You are soft. And you are.
But if you're of the majority, you know, then it's a lot easier to get the good rating and show your movie in a theater.
Nazi prom queen. Bruised knuckle boy. Tired of crawling.
House is just my savior. I make my living here. I have my best friend here. You know, I have all my peace here, and I feel safe. So.
And you live? You both live here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah, we both got divorced at the same time. Mm-hmm. My son was 5. Her daughter was 5, and we just moved in together and been there ever since. So I always call her daughter my daughter because I feel like she is. I raised her when she was 5. Wow. So. When I was growing up, the word lesbian and gay was bad. It was a sin. It was something that you just didn't do. And I always seemed to be more attracted towards women and girls. Well, it was girls then. 5 Victor X-ray, Edward C-H-E. And then one day my aunt said she thought I was a lesbian. And that just freaked me out. And that was not going to be acceptable, you know. And I was like, oh my God. So. I met Russ a few months later and just felt I needed to get married and do what everybody wanted me to do. And then after about 6 years of marriage, I met a woman on the military base and just brought out feelings in me that I had never felt in my life. And one day I'm just like, you know, how could something that makes me feel so good be wrong? And I was just telling Lindsay, you know, I love Cheryl more than I could ever imagine loving anyone in my life. I mean, she's everything to me. She's my best friend, you know, and I just could never imagine being with anybody else. And if someone told me, well, you have to be with a guy, you can't do this, then I would rather just be alone than to not have that complete fulfillment. G-N-C-H-E 672.
Wait, oh my gosh, this one matches up. That one. The
Joan Grace.
Oh yeah, Joan Grace.
That it's somewhat detrimental to have a manager who holds hiring and firing power to be sitting there in judgment of people's rating decisions.
So yeah, he could be very kind of unyielding and intolerant and really tried to intimidate us into sort of going along with what the majority point of view was.
Sometimes people would be inclined to try to pull rank or something, you know, and that sort of thing is problematic, you know.
How would they pull rank?
Well, just attitude, in attitudes, you know, say, that's out of line with the way that film should be rated, sort of categorically, that you need to get with the group think.
If there was a tie vote, which I think it could be, because I think sometimes we had 8 people, so it could be like 4-4, and then the chairman of the board could really kind of arbitrarily make the decision. And usually, when I was on the board, he was going to make the decision for the more restrictive rating, the more conservative rating.
But he voted. Didn't he already vote?
Yes, yes. So he was one of the votes, and there was no kind of other method for any kind of tie-breaking. It was just sort of he had the right to do what he wanted in that case. Frankly, he had the right to do what he wanted, even because I was amazed in one case that it had been voted like a 5-3 in favor of the R, and then we found out that the movie was being cut. And so I was like puzzled. I said, I don't understand that. You know, it already got an R. Why is this happening? And so one of the board members said, well, we don't object to cuts to make it a better R.
It's just two puppets in sexual positions. And the whole joke is that's what kids have done for years. Take your G.I. Joe and your Barbie and look at how they're doing, you know. The first thing they came back to Paramount was, you can have Missionary and her on top and that's it. And we were just like, that's not a joke. That's just like two, that's nothing. That's two positions. You can't even make a scene out of that. But we purposely left in stuff that you don't even want in the scene, because you have to give them something to cut so they feel like they pissed on it somewhat. So we left the sex scene just, we put in basically every second of footage we cut. It's like 4-minute like sex scene. It's just ridiculous. And it's not the way it should have been cut. It was bad, you know, it's not even good for the movie. And we ended up shooting extra shots that we didn't even want to put in there, that we just put in there. You push the line way back, so maybe they only cut to here kind of thing.
I also had heard on a dirty shame, and I have no proof of this, that there were doctors involved and said that we know, and that some of the kinkier terms like felching and stuff, they explained to the MPA what felching meant. Now, I would like to have heard that, because felching, no one has ever done felching. Felching is when you fuck someone and suck your own cum out of their asshole. Well, I know a lot of perverts, and I don't know anyone that's done that. And I said that in my appeal. I didn't say what felching was, but they supposedly had been told, and I was going to say if they brought up they had heard what the terms I wanted to say, no, that's farting in the bathtub and biting the bubble, because who can approve what what this really is?
You put your backside in, you put your backside out, you put your backside in, and you shake it all about.
So my contract said it had to be an R rating, and I said, oh, come on. It's a non-explicit American comedy starring Tracy Ullman, for God's sake. This is not a real dirty movie. So I sent it, I was a little nervous, and I got the call, and they said NC-17. And I said, I'm kind of really surprised. And the man said, you are surprised? I thought, oh, and I said, well, what could I cut? And they said, to be honest, we stopped taking notes. That's when my blood turned to ice water, because that's what you fear the most. When they say, from overall, that's the reason, which means, and they said, there's 1,000 brush strokes in this. You can't cut 10. And I was very, I think, fair about sexuality. I was responsible. They were safe sex. It might be perverted, but it's safe. You can't get pregnant. You can't get AIDS. What's the matter? I think from what I read now, in 8th grade, girls give blowjobs routinely. Well, if I was a parent, I hope they were sploshing instead of giving blowjobs.
Sploshing is the erotic urge to dump food in your private area.
I think you ought to hope your children are doing perverted sex acts with food. Now, right when A Dirty Shame was rated, about a week or two before it, the Iraq pictures had been released from the prison. Nobody was in a great mood about making jokes about weird sexuality. And I think that had something to do with it. I think it could have in a weird way. But I think what it said to me this time, this rating was, not only can't you make a movie where you show sex all through it, you can't even talk about sex all through it. That's new to me, it seems.
Okay, I've been running background checks, court searches, things like that on the possible raiders. And I don't think they're raiders. I think they probably work in advertising or anti-piracy. Is the guard going? He's using their time to chat on the phone. Oh my gosh, there's extensions hanging on the wall.
What? Oh, in his booth?
Are you serious, Becky?
Yes. You see it?
No.
Okay, you see the phone is hanging in the window?
In his booth?
Yeah, look in the far window.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay, you see the phone?
Mm-hmm.
Right above there is a list.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got names of extensions. I wonder if I can get it with my camera. Look, the security guard's leaving.
What are the chances of that?
Let's go, Lindsay. While I'm filming, you watch for me. Make sure nobody's coming. Okay? Walk back by. Check it out. Nobody's here. Yes, but not enough. There's all kinds of stuff sitting in there. They have memos and office extensions.
But what was on the list?
Everybody's names and extensions.
Did you get it?
But I don't know how good of a picture I got. Hi, good morning. I'm trying to reach Joanne Yatabi, and I keep getting her voicemail. Is she in a screening right now? What time do you think they'll be out? 9:30. Okay, and they come out for a break. Thank you. Bye-bye. It's like a puzzle, you know? And you just start with one piece and you gradually just slowly put it together until you come up with the full picture.
So what time is it now?
5:39.
5:39. They must have a long movie that they're watching.
Yeah.
Here's somebody.
There she is.
Oh,
Tommy? Yeah. Look at the plate just to make sure, but I'm sure it's her. She's the only one that has the tan jack. See, I don't want to get too close to her. I don't want to look at her either.
I'm going to put on my safety belt.
She's
in. Uh-oh. Is she setting you up here?
Maybe.
This is weird.
If she's driving in to see if we're following her.
Did she seem like she knew she was being followed?
No.
Don't you think she'd back up?
She drove into the Humane Society. That's weird. We should get out of here.
Yeah, but I don't want to lose her. I just want to make sure there's not a way out. There she is. She picked someone up. Yeah, she's right there. Okay, hold on. Okay, I'm gonna have to stop here. They went into the chicken place. Well, I'll just go in and just sit by them and eat something little, see what they're talking about.
Get a shot.
And get a shot.
Hello? Hello? Uh-huh. Becky's camera isn't working. I've got to get this shot.
Is he filming us? And I was like, oh my God, Lindsay, what am I gonna do? So I jumped up and go, do you know him? And they're all, no, do you know him? I go, no. And they go, yeah, only in LA would you find someone that weird.
Is that a gram? New card. What do you think?
Whoa, very nice. Look at that.
Picked them up from the printers yesterday.
Good coloring.
That's bone. And the lettering is something called Cillian Braille.
It's very cool, Bateman, but that's nothing. Look at this.
So we finished the film, we presented it, and we had a call back that the board objected. They wanted to give it NC-17 because they objected to the entire tone of the film. And we just sort of laughed because, you know, how do you change the tone of a movie? And then there was, you know, the ratings board is not a monolith. You know, there are differing shades of opinion, and there was a lot of back and forth discussion, and then it came down to really a few things. Chainsaw scene, which I thought was going to be a problem, the axe murder, you know, that was fine, and it was basically just sex. It was the three-way sex scene. And it was particularly rear entry sex. You know, any sort of unusual forms of sex, I think, are a problem for the ratings board.
Why do you think they had a problem with these scenes?
I think maybe because porn is very clear. You absolutely know where you are with porn. You know, it's a straight sort of, you know, graphic depiction of sex for a purpose. And then you know where you are with entertainment because it's kind of, you know, escapist and you know, romanticized or takes you into another dream world. And then art movies tend to rub your face in things. They tend to more challenge you or disturb you.
The fact is that this whole controversy is whether or not you can make a dozen more adult pictures a year. I don't think many parents are going to fret because their children can't see a sex orgy on the screen.
What strikes you immediately about the MPAA, and I'm sure I'm the, you know, 300th person to say this, is how much more they seem to be concerned about sex than they are about violence.
Whereas the movie rating systems in Europe have the exact opposite view, much more open about sexual depictions, much more restrictive about violent depictions than the MPAA.
If you see a movie like Sin City, which is R-rated and is just full of dismemberments, decapitation, the most grisly kind of violence, but that gets an R, and yet you see like a film like The Dreamers, which is sex among three young people, and not even explicit hardcore sex, and that still is rated NC-17.
Fact is, it's not true. Most pictures that get an NC-17 rating, the adult rating, or have to do with violence.
But it just seems backwards that to show human sexuality in pretty much any form is, you know, getting into our territory, while you can shoot as many bodies as long as there's no blood and be PG-13. I mean, you know, what are we training our kids for? You know, you're not showing the result of what happens when you fire a gun. So I think it should be flipped. I think if you show violence without blood, it's like fantasy, and the only people that could actually handle that intellectually are adults. But if you show violence with blood, it should be a PG-13 so that people can actually realize the result of what it actually does.
If I were to create a rating system, I wouldn't even put murder right at the top of the chief offenses. I would put rape right at the top of the chief offenses.
and assault against women, because it's so insanely overused and insulting how much it's overused in movies as a plot device, a woman in peril. That to me is offensive, yet that shit skates.
We studied 98 of the 100 top-grossing films from 1994 for this particular study on the ratings system. And what we discovered was that they aren't doing a very good job at discriminating for violence. The film industry is engaged in producing a product, and for very fundamental reasons, violence sells, especially to their target demographic. It's not coincidental that that target demographic is also the most at risk for violence in American society.
You remember Columbine? As soon as Columbine occurred, Jack and the others circled the wagons and defended the industry. And Jack said, nobody knows what the impact of media violence is, and it's true. Nobody knows point by point what the relationship is between this act of violence on the screen and this act of violence in real life. Nobody knows cause and effect, but you can over a period of time get the judgments of the people who deal with the kids and others who commit violence, and their judgment from the first Surgeon General's report on has been almost unanimously that it's a negative input.
So we think it's not too much to ask of a group of people who have embraced the responsibility of informing parents what's going on in films to inform themselves about what's going on in the research regarding this connection.
I'd rather have the person who went to medical school tell me something about a medical problem. This person who studied psychiatry to tell me what the psychiatrists know about the impact upon children of violence or sexuality or anything. So I do want to bring in expert opinion.
Two or three back.
Three? Yeah. Like a motion sensor. Just give it a lot. I'm serious. It's basically like socks and like a little bit of an outline of a body. Okay, here she comes. Here she comes.
These are always the fun things.
Wow, interesting. Credit rating, I see. Well, this is from Macy's, okay?
Wow, what's this? I honestly don't know what this credit summary.
Name of film. Name. Oh, this is. Whoa. Oh, this is a. Oh, this is Hebrew. This is.
Is that what they write up?
It looks like it. These are like blank forms or something, right? Let's see. Oh, here we go. Good. This is on Memoirs of a Geisha. This gets a PG-13. Sex and our nudity. Okay. Chayo peeks in on Hatsumoto having sex with boyfriend in her room. He's on top, gyrating around, and stops when he spots Chayo. Mrs. Nita sticks her hand into Hatsumoto's robe and inserts her fingers into her vagina.
And that's got a PG?
That got a PG-13. She moves her hand and shows her wet fingers to prove she's just had sex.
Oh, my God. Okay, and then... Look, we have Get Rich and Die Trying. That's coming out, next week.
Who's making that? This is R for strong violence, language, some sexuality, and nudity. Okay, sex and our nudity. Marcus gets up from bed between two women. One woman is topless, breast exposed. Inside prison shower, nude prisoners, penis and ass cheeks exposed.
And they rated it what?
R. Look at that language.
Wait.
Fucks, 20 plus. Motherfuckers, 20 plus. So what I don't understand is who's counted the fucks?
It's a substantial loss for society when you think that there are people who could be censors of anything. And the MPAA is one of the last vestiges of a censorship system.
After you watch this, you're gonna go get your popcorn out of the microwave and talk about what I say. And you'll forget me by the end of this.
When we first started shooting Gunner Palace in Baghdad, the soldiers in the palace, all that they asked was that I tell it like it is. You know, tell the people what our life is like. You know, uncensored, unfiltered. You know, this is their day to day. This is their life. After we finished editing Gunner Palace, we submitted it for a rating from the MPAA. And I think about 6 weeks later, the rating came back, and it was an R. It was for language and drug use.
Who the fuck them motherfuckers up, man?
You know, these are soldiers in a war zone. Like, what do you expect? They're gonna say, oh, darn, you know, a mortar almost landed on me. This is not fiction. This is reality. These are real soldiers. They're living in a war zone. The language is not gratuitous. You know, we're not instructing people to bleed off these obscenities. You know, this is just their life. And it's also not scripted.
Smoke a weed, can't smoke in the army. Nigga trying to harm me, bomb me, don't give a fuck. Vietnam putting it down.
Joan Graves' take on this was rules are rules. And there's no way and you're going to get a PG-13, you know, gentlemen, you're simply, you know, you're wasting our time. She also pointed out that if they did rate a film like ours, PG-13, that they would hear from pressure groups. They would start getting calls, they would start getting letters. And I found this really revealing. It didn't seem so much that it's about representing the majority opinion of America. It seems more about kind of bowing to pressure.
The worst thing that could happen, well, if you had diarrhea right now, that would probably suck pretty fucking bad.
This is the language that's spoken. Yeah, it's horrible. Yes, we may not agree with it. We might even be disgusted by it. But when the Americans liberated Buchenwald and they saw these images, you know, these heaps of people, is that PG? Is that PG-13? Is that R? People needed to see that. When the little girl's running down the road in South Vietnam, you know, burnt by napalm and she's naked, is that PG? Is that PG-13? Is it R? I mean, you can't rate reality. And if you can't deal with it, that don't send people to war.
Put it on the camp. Those people have it. We don't. Over.
The military and the film studios have colluded for more than 50 years. Anytime filmmakers want military assets, ships or tanks or planes, they have to give the Pentagon 5 copies of their script. If there's anything in the script that's negative, the Pentagon wants them to take it out, and so they negotiate and take out any war crimes or foul language or drinking, anything that would make the military look bad. And then after the agreement is made, the military sends a minder onto the set when the film is being shot to make sure it's shot just the way they agreed. And then once the film is completed, it has to be shown to the Pentagon admirals and generals before it's shown to the public. Dozens of films have not been made because they couldn't get military assistance. So people have no idea what they're not seeing. Jack Valenti knew what was going on. He was complicit in it, and he was part of it. You know, it's just a subtle form of brainwashing, I believe, that 50 years of the constant drumbeat of military is good, American soldiers are heroic and valiant, I think has made the American people more warlike over the last 50 years.
you know, I think we need to step back for a second and wonder sort of what all this means, that two or three companies completely control the information in our country. And when we think about censorship, what's being censored are scenes in movies, which mean nothing to these people. And of course, what's not being regulated is the ways in which these corporations control the flow of information in the recording industry, in the film industry, TV industry, radio, press, everything.
And by the time it's completed, you know, and we have three, maybe two companies that essentially own access to our culture, it'll be impossible to break up, because the political power of those companies will be so massive, and they will be willing to spend extraordinary amounts to protect their cartel position, that no government will be strong enough to stand up to them.
I want to pay particular gratitude to the members of Congress who are here today. It pleases me greatly that you've come, and it pleases me even more that you come from both sides of the aisle. I was struck with Ted Stevens. I've never heard that before, but I'd like to claim that, Ted, when you said he has friends on both sides of the aisle, but he doesn't know about an aisle. I like that.
No doubt there's a problem with piracy, but we've got to make sure that we don't spray DDT to kill a gnat, and that's what I think is happening here. We're not thinking about the cultural, environmental consequences from this extraordinary war, a war which Jack Valenti calls his own, quote, terrorist war against the, quote, pirates. You know, terrorist war? Who are the terrorists here? Our children. We're talking about our children as terrorists.
The people who are copyright, who are pirates, at least in the American imaginary, are like 17-year-old boys who are clever enough to figure out a way to do it. They're also Hollywood's best customers, still. So even though they're pirating information, they're still going to a whole lot of movies, still buying a whole lot of DVDs, buying soundtracks. So, part of me doesn't feel tremendously sorry for huge corporations that make ridiculous profits, maybe losing a little bit of profits to this sort of network that actually ultimately may end up helping them. Because it just creates this sort of constant exchange about their movies that didn't exist before.
The MPAA has a very powerful hold on the culture, and the licensing system that they have, the appeals board and the ratings is just part of it. I mean, they are a group that ought to have its power whittled down.
You are dealing with a very powerful cultural censorship group that doesn't want to be disempowered. And if you made those names public, you might disempower them.
Is there any other review group that you can think of in this country, in any industry besides the CIA, that is secret, that operates in secrecy?
Wow. No.
If you're going to take on that type of a public policy role for American culture, then I don't think that you should be hiding in a veil of secrecy. I know the MPAA has said they're afraid that these people will be under pressure, but there are many people that have judgments, important judgments about things that are under pressure or influenced. I mean, judges or prosecutors or, you know, school officials, but they all operate in the public sphere, and I think these people should as well.
Becky, and I'm calling to confirm some names with you because we're going to be sending a package off to the ratings department. I have Joan, Marianne, Cheryl, Joanne, Anthony, Mary, Scott, Alex, Howard, Barry, Matthew, Arlene, Joan, and Danielle. Is there anyone I'm missing? Corey Jones? Okay, great, thank you so much. Bye-bye. She was so sweet, she went to get the list to make sure I had all the people. Ready, Lindsay? Wait, she's getting on the 405. Doing at least 90. And he's not even looking.
I got him. He doesn't look happy.
No, he doesn't. Right,
got a Raider.
Yeehaw, we got him. He looked right at us. Oh, here we go, Arlene. She's attractive. There he is. Get the best shot, Eddie.
Time to go.
She's walking with the light. Right there. She looks different in person than in her car. We have two Raiders here. There he is.
Where?
Right there in front of us. In yoga class.
You did?
Yes. Okay, here he comes.
He looks like George Lucas.
Is this the MPAA? Could I have the film ratings department? Yes. I'd like to submit my film for a rating. It's a documentary. It's about the film business. Okay. Is this for the ratings board? Okay, is it going up right now? Okay, what's your name?
George.
George, okay, great. Thanks a lot.
How are you feeling?
It's strange because, you know, you're so small and this organization is so big. You're sort of at the mercy of fate, I guess. Hello? Hi, how you doing? That's great. Do you mind if I just ask you, would you mind if we record this conversation? Okay, so it's fine. Okay, thank you very much. So, was everybody able to see the film?
Yeah, I have a rating for you. It's NC-17 for some graphic sexual content.
Okay, so it's NC-17 for graphic sexual content. Some graphic sexual content. Okay. Now, because I'm very, very interested in this being as accurate as possible, were there any, glaring inaccuracies in it that you might let me know about, or,
I'm not gonna comment on the film in any other aspect than the rating aspect of it.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi, how you doing?
You're not taping this conversation, are you?
No, I'm not taping the conversation.
Are you a parent?
I am a parent.
Well, do you feel there's material in your film you wouldn't want your children to see?
It's really all dependent on the child and the context in which they see it, actually.
Well, I don't think you'd be a very good raider.
You don't think I'm going to be a good raider myself?
No.
Well, do you ever do interviews at all?
No.
Well, but why? I mean, I don't understand why the names are anonymous, because,
their names are kept secret so they can come to work every day and not feel pressure.
But it seems like the raiders who you're trying to protect from influence actually are in direct contact with the people who can influence them, the senior raiders especially.
They are strong people and I trust them.
Well, why can't you have an entire board of those kind of people and not worry about it and just have it public? Now that the public will know their names, will the same raiders continue to rate the films?
I haven't thought about that.
Well, let me ask you this. What was the vote, of the raiders?
We don't disclose that.
Can you tell me if it was close or not close or anything like that?
It wasn't close.
Could you send out the notes that people take or whatever the ratings that the individual, raiders do?
No.
Okay. And how many people saw it?
We don't give out that information.
And if I, resubmit to try to get an R rating and I take out some footage, how do I know that I won't take out something that I didn't need to take out?
I guess you can't know, but if less graphic material is there, we're in a better position to help you.
Okay, so I formally accept the NC-17, and I think I should probably at this point move to the appeal stage. Now, in your opinion and your experience, do you think I'd have a chance to overturn the appeal?
No, I don't think so, but you are welcome to try.
So I said, okay, we're going to do the appeal. Before I called, we asked how it works, and they explained you the rules, and the woman, who was not the head woman, she said, and we serve cookies, and please do not get crumbs on the floor, which, of course, when we lost, I wanted to, crush the crumbs into the rug, but I didn't.
But it's a weird situation, because they don't let you just speak. They say to you, you cannot stand up there and say, well, you know what, in Basic Instinct, Sharon Stone opened her legs, we saw everything, and you gave that an R rating, never mind just pubic hair. And then they'll go, they don't want, it's not like a legal proceeding where you can quote precedent. They won't allow you to quote any precedent.
And that's what I said to them, well, what other guideline do I have? I said, I've seen every, I go to the movies all the time with audiences in Baltimore, which is real America. And I thought I know what is allowed in an R-rated movie. I have seen some of these teen comedies, which I'm fine with, but are really rude, and are more anti-women than my movies, I think. So if you cannot use your own history with the MPAA, what are the guidelines? I mean, all I can do is see everything that comes out and see what you've rated it recently.
And then, there was a quick, tallying of the votes, which I don't know quite how they tallied the votes. But then they said, you did a great job. But we're sorry to say you lost. But you just lost by a margin. And I was so devastated because I had bought into the fact that this was a system whereby I could win.
It's kind of like the pat on the back, nice try. And suddenly the curtain opens, an assistant comes in and she says, it's 9-3. You could kind of hear this sense of relief, this sigh of relief from Joan Graves, And the assistant was like, it's 9-3, it's overturned. And I think what's interesting about our case was that it was really a shock to her. It was like, number one, how dare you come in and challenge it? And number two, how dare you win?
Is this suicide doing this? I don't know, because there's only one of them. I got to go back to them next time.
Are you at all concerned that if they see you in the film, that they'll look differently at your next film?
Yeah, I don't know what, I don't know what commenting on the very board that has the power to give you a rating to get out into the culture is going to do to how stringent they will be on my next film. I guess I would hope not.
Hello, this is Kirby.
I want to make sure you're aware of the things that we don't allow. First, you can't compare scenes in your film to similar scenes in other films.
Well, let me ask you about that. Can I compare films as a whole, then, from one film, compare my film to another film?
No. Referring to any other film is never allowed.
Can I go ahead and do that? Will anything happen?
I will cut you off.
You're going to cut me off?
Yes, I will.
To restrict me in that way is sort of, I mean, you are part of the MPAA. They are the people, that I'm, it's their organization that I'm, sort of up against here. And then you're restricting my opportunity to speak. It's like I'm going kind of into a stacked situation here in a way. I mean, at least I'm actually very surprised to hear that I would actually get cut off.
It's not I can't even speak, Kirby, basically, but every system has its rules and you have to follow those rules.
But do I introduce myself individually to each person? They say, hi, I'm such and such from such and such.
No, I'm afraid we don't do that.
Can I have a list of the people that are there just so that I know who those people are who've made a decision?
No, absolutely
I can't even have a list of the people who made a decision about my film?
No, You don't need to know those
Well, that,
names.
Wait a minute. That doesn't seem right. Because, I mean, this is not a secret board. I mean, the ratings board is secret, but this isn't secret. So why can't I at least have a list of those names? I mean, that seems like a sort of a star chamber or something. They're gone. Hello? 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 Hello?
We're here.
Oh, where'd you go?
We're just looking at the rules.
Oh, I see. Well, but nonetheless, Greg, why can't I have that list of those names? I mean,
Kirby, we choose not to make those names public.
But it's not a secret board, is it?
I'm not going to tell you their names.
From the very beginning, when we got our NC-17 rating, there was an undue emphasis put on the fact that it was not to do with the homosexual content. And that was repeated, and it made me actually come to understand that it probably was to do with that.
Fuck Vince! We're buddies, we're pals, we're partners, we're a duo. We love each other, but we don't. Fuck!
The lady who was there from the MPAA told me, you're so close. You know, if only you could make that scene a bit fuzzier. And then she stopped herself and said, no, but I'm not an artist. I don't know how you compose that. And I felt like saying, no, that's brilliant what you're saying. Keep going, you know, like, would you like to edit my next film? You're a visionary.
It's Dennis from Screen International.
I can always say I gave it our best shot. I mean, we really did. And what they were asking us to do at this point would have been, you know, completely unacceptable. So the film will go out as it was originally intended. There's nothing to do. I mean, you can't reappeal. You know, we resubmitted it in two different versions, and this was the final stage. In this particular case, it means that people won't be able to see the film theatrically in many parts of the country. The other thing that was very surprising, I must say, which I only found today, is that there are members of the clergy in the room. They are specifically from two denominations, Episcopalian and Catholic, and there's no rotating basis. I mean, it's always going to be Episcopalian and Catholic. They do not vote, but they are part of the secret discussion, which you are not privy to.
Who is the person who's usually there from CARA?
It is usually Joan Gray's, but I mean a different person from the MPAA actually, you know, runs it. Usually one of their attorneys.
I see. Do you know their names?
I probably shouldn't divulge.
So even the chair, that's also secret?
Well, yes, it's probably better if we don't mention names.
So now these two members of the clergy are there too, right?
As observers.
As observers. Do they ever ask any questions?
Or no.
No.
They are not permitted according to the rules.
So they actually are totally mum. They don't speak at all. So what do they do when they're there?
They behave the same way as all of us. They watch the movie, possibly participate in the discussion, and they cast a vote.
They do cast a vote?
Yes.
Have there always been clergy since the time that you've been there?
Mm-hmm.
What did you think about that?
Since they were only observers, I really didn't give it a second thought.
What is the kind of rationale behind having clergy on the board?
I have no idea. I guess they feel that maybe they have a horse in the race and that they should be entitled to an opinion, but I don't know, honestly.
Why are they there?
Frankly, I really haven't thought about that because I don't consider them part of the process. You know, they're just there. So it's sort of part of the wallpaper, so.
I'm already divulging a lot here that I probably shouldn't be divulging. I just, at some point, I think I have to draw a line and be careful.
This is something that we need you to look into. This is a really important thing we found out. We found out that there are two members of the clergy on the appeals board.
Really?
A Catholic priest and an Episcopalian priest. And this is the backroom deal that they don't tell anybody about. So, is that
curious.
Something you can do?
Absolutely, I'm just curious.
How would you go about doing that, though?
One, they would be associated with a church.
Okay.
Okay, well, if I run their names, it'll come up with all the associations.
I see.
If they are ministers, the church is going to come up.
Oh, I see.
Okay.
Cool.
I have been asked by the National Council of Churches to represent them, Protestants,
and join forces, if you will, with the Catholic office, and they have representatives that come. And our role is to attend the hearings for appeals.
The relationship between church groups and censorship is apparent, palpable. It always has been, whether it be Lenny Bruce or whether it be Comstock.
Valenti, wisely, I think, felt that this should be a transparent process, but it couldn't be broadcast to the public. So he reached the conclusion that with religious representatives in the room, that would at least indicate to the religious bodies and to the public, if they ask, that this is an above board process.
There's a whole moralistic tone to the room. I mean, these are moral censors. These are people who are making judgments about other people's morality. There aren't that many places in the United States where you get that.
How is the vote taken?
It's, what do you mean, how is it taken?
How are the votes cast in the appeal?
Ask Joan that. I mean, just everybody knows who comes to the meetings, but I don't think that's a question I should answer.
What is your relationship like with Joan Graves?
We're friends, and I respect her film knowledge, and I respect the tough job that she has. And she has the delicate role of trying to make the filmmaker realize, make your picture, make it work. But realize that if you go down this road too far, you're cutting off a certain audience, and that's your choice. We don't want to restrict the film artist. We want to give the artist the freedom to make the films they want to make. But we do not want to make it totally free.
December 21st, 2005 was the day of my appeal. No cameras or press were permitted inside the building, and there was no written record of the proceedings. The chair was Greg Gechner, the attorney for the MPAA. Everyone was given a badge with only a number on it. My number was 22. After introducing myself, I asked for the names of the people on the appeals board. The chair refused my request. I then asked for the name of the member of clergy present. That name was also refused. When I turned to the board and asked if any one of them would identify themselves, there was complete silence. The chair suggested that if I had a problem with the system, I should send a letter to the MPAA. I countered that it was the basic right of any appellant to know the people deciding his appeal. A board member yelled out that I was confused about the rules, and another shouted that I was wasting their time. The NC-17 rating was upheld by a 10-0 vote. I later learned the MPAA was so afraid of exposing the names of the appeals board members that Joan Graves made a special arrangement for them to meet first, and then she transported them all in and out of the building in a black van with tinted windows. But what they didn't know is that 3 months earlier, on the date of another appeal, Becky was outside that same building.
Okay, Lindsay. Victor Adam Paul 038. Yeah, this is really good. 2 Charles Adam
6-1-9. What's going to be on my tombstone, Harry, but I'd like to write it and say that the modest legacy that Jack Valenti left the movie industry was he freed the screen from all artificial barriers.